37 years ago, there was a very definite air of excitement in Pensacola. Pensacolians had been warned, forewarned, of the advent of WCOA. And of course, this was an event of no small means, because it was the fifth radio station to go on the air in Florida. Equally excited, and perhaps more so, were the performers, announcers, who were to appear on the initial broadcast the night of February 3rd, 1926. Present as a performer that night, and a performer frequently thereafter, was Mrs. W.R. Healy, who has invited us into her home to talk about those days. Mrs. Healy, were you kind of nervous that night?
Well, there was very much excitement in the town, and Johnny had everything prepared so well that I think the program went off quite well.
Mrs. Healy, you sang before 1926 and long after 1926, and you were a regular feature on WCOA, were you not?
Oh, yes. Johnny once a month would write the singers, and in Pensacola at that time we had quite a few good singers, and ask them if they would give a 15-minute program. So we did.
You were accompanied by...
Oh, Elizabeth Marina was quite a faithful accompanist to most of the singers.
Mrs. Healy, even prior to your singing on the air the first night the WCOA broadcast, you had done some radio broadcasting to the north of us, hadn't you?
Oh, yes. I came here from Montgomery, Alabama, and there was quite some excitement there. This man had just an Exide battery shop, and he rigged up a radio, and we gave broadcasts there frequently. And they were heard as far north as Pennsylvania. We got letters from people who had heard the programs.
In fact, I saw a postcard, postmarked 1924, remembering a particular tune that you had sung on this experimental radio station. So you truly are a radio pioneer vocalist.
Well, I guess I am.
And you're still active in music, aren't you, Mrs. Healy?
Oh, yes. I teach voice here in my own studio, and I have quite a number of pupils, high school, nurses. I actually have some of my naval officers taking lessons from me.
Well, I think it's wonderful that you've been able to continue music on through. What personalities do you remember from those early days, not only 1926, but in the years following? Personalities whom other Pensacolians might remember, and possibly those who may have gone on to bigger things.
Actually, Felix Knight, who became a member of the Metropolitan Opera Company, I sang with him, and he used to be a regular singer on WCOA.
What was broadcasting like then? Was it particularly nerve-wracking for you, or was it just as easy as appearing on stage or before a small group of people?
Well, most of the singers had their own favorite repertoire, and of course, ours was classical music. That was the most popular thing for singers at that time, although they did work in some of the lighter, popular standard songs.
Did you enjoy radio? I'm perhaps, you know, at the time it may have been kind of nerve-wracking for you, but did you enjoy working?
Oh, yes, it was a lot of fun. And then, of course, you know, we weren't seen.
Well, that may have given you a certain anonymity. Mrs. Healy, we certainly appreciate you inviting us into your home, and we've enjoyed talking with you as we have with others, reminiscing over the 37 years ago that COA went on the air. Wonderful City of Advantages was what WCOA stood for and still stands for. Do you still feel that Pensacola is that wonderful city of advantages?
Oh, I surely do. And I want to congratulate WCOA for having such a wonderful library of classical music. I think they contribute to the culture of this town, city it is now.
We want to thank you once again, Mrs. Healy. This has been another of WCOA's conversations in connection with our 37th anniversary. Richard H. Merritt, Sr., prominent Pensacola attorney, was on hand in Pensacola during the time of WCOA's inception and ultimate airtime in February 1926. Mr. Merritt, there were quite a bit of speculation in Pensacola as to whether WCOA would actually be able to broadcast in February 26. Can you reflect just a bit on that?
Well, I remember all the fanfare about it and how excited we were, and we wondered whether we'd be able to get it in our homes or whether we'd have to go down to some business establishment or some particular studio set up to hear it. We were wondering whether...
Hello, test 1 2 3 4 4 3 2 1. Hello, testing 1 2 3 4 5.
My recollection back then.
Test 1 2 3 4. Test 1 2 3 4. This is a take.
I am Roy Lundreiner, County Commissioner of Escambia County, and I want to congratulate radio station WCOA on its 37th anniversary. I am a regular listener to WCOA, and particularly like the news in the morning and Pensacola Speaks in the evening. Of course, the music and other features throughout the day are all fine. Again, I want to congratulate WCOA and wish them many more years of successful operation. Roy Lundreiner signing off.
Test 1-2. 1-2 test.
This is Vincent Carroll, County Commissioner. I want to take this opportunity to congratulate WCOA on its 37th year of broadcast. This brings back memories for me. When WCOA went on the air February 3rd, 1926, I was a student in Nano Barris' School of Music. We furnished the music for the first program that was broadcasted from WCOA, which Mr. Johnny Frinkel was master of ceremonies, and he has been known ever since, the breezy boy from the Gulf of Mexico. I want to take this opportunity to congratulate WCOA for the fine service that they have rendered all of these years to the people of Pensacola and Escambia County. Thank you.
Well, my record.
I'm A.S. Cobb, County Commissioner, District 2. As Chairman of the Board of County Commissioners of Escambia County, I wish to congratulate WCOA on their 37th anniversary, and to all express my own as well as the best wishes for the whole community for your splendid service and cooperation you have given not only to Escambia County, but to the surrounding area. I trust that you will be able to render this type of service for many years to come. Thank you.
W.H. Abbott, County Commissioner, District 4, Escambia County. Congratulations to WCOA on their 37th anniversary. It is a pleasure to have such a station to listen to each day. I hope you have many more years of wonderful service to our community. Thanks.
The West and open up the Western trails to compare with the highways of today. There's no comparison in it, but I think they did a tremendous job at that time, and I want to say that every day that I've known WCOA, they've improved their entire program and been a tremendous asset to this community.
Well, Mr. Richard H. Merritt, we want to thank you very much for taking time from an extremely busy schedule to talk with us in commemoration of this, the 37th anniversary of WCOA.
Well, thank you very much for letting me appear. Goodbye.
Eddie Collins has a long history in Pensacola music and also in electronics. And of course, back in 1926, the word electronics, I don't think, had even been born yet. But radio was a very going affair. WCOA almost wasn't a going affair because on the night of February 3rd, trouble was brewing in the WCOA studios, at that time located in City Hall. Eddie, you were to appear on the program that night in a musical capacity, and when you showed up, there was a little bit of concern in the air, wasn't there?
Well, yes, it was. At the moment that I walked in, the inspector, Mr. Van Nostrand, was standing in the transmitter room that was adjacent to the studios, and he said, well, here's a radio amateur. He can put you on the air. And I asked Mr. Lloyd what his problem was. Mr. Lloyd, is better known as C.E. Lloyd, was very prominent in broadcast radio at those days, building numerous receivers for people around town, the old Neutrodyne and so forth. And he said, every time we try to put it on the air, it flashes over, and I can't figure out what's the matter. So I went over and looked at it, and it was the old Hartley circuit the amateurs were familiar with. And Mr. Lloyd had inadvertently reversed the grid and plate leads on the final inductance. So I asked him to make the switch, and he did, and the transmitter came on the air, and I think I could have owned WCOA at that moment because it was about 3 to 4 minutes prior to our time to come on the air.
And then you immediately went from an engineering capacity to that of musician, didn't you?
Well, let's leave me back at the amateur status. And I did go in, and we had the Rainbow Orchestra. And at that time, Gene Villar was playing drums. Frank Howland was playing banjo. Sybil McNair was playing piano. And Johnny Capodonico was playing second sax. And I was holding forth on the trusty C melody. And we broadcast the program with our knees shaking. That was our first broadcast.
Tell me, Eddie, were conditions, especially for musicians, nerve-wracking in those early days of radio, when both you and radio were pretty new to each other?
Well, I don't think they were any worse than they are at present, but of course I'm not familiar with how things are going. But Pensacola was small. We were all proud of Pensacola, and we still are. And everyone seemed to know everyone. If you played in a band, you went to town, everybody knew you, and you knew everybody. And there was a lot closer relation between the audience and the musicians. And that existed with all bands. There were two or three bands in town, Honey Grossjohn, and Tony Bruno, and Brian Motto, and others that I don't mean to leave out, I just can't recall at the moment.
Well, Eddie, moving from the musical side of things, you've been very active in electronics, ham radio, amateur radio, for a number of years. And you started out quite a long time before COA was even in the embryonic stage.
Oh, yes. Of course, that was one of the reasons I probably was in the transmitting room, because there was so little in modern equipment that we had a chance to observe that we jumped at any opportunity to see equipment. So I was right in there looking and seeing what I could see. Most of the equipment we would manufacture ourselves, coils and condensers, transformers and so forth. And they just weren't available. You couldn't buy them if you were lucky enough to have a job that would give you the money to buy them.
Tell me, in those days, 26, of course, there's really no comparison between that type of transmitting equipment that commercial stations used and that used today. I suppose it was quite a bit cruder, wasn't it?
Well, practically all of the transmitters were composite, and WCOA at that time was self-excited. In other words, it didn't have a crystal to set the frequency to give you the stability of the modern-day transmitters that stay on their frequency. Well, they're always at the same spot. Let's put it that way. I don't want to go branching off too far on this stuff. But the crystal control of WCOA came in later. And there was an engineer named Strobel who came in to do this work. And Then later he was followed by Hayford, and there's quite a string of people, and everyone contributed. And of course, Johnny Franco was always in there. It was his heart, and he loves Pensacola, and he loves everything connected with it. And Pensacola was well advertised on the air by Johnny's efforts, and he was program director and the announcer, and was always known as the Breezy Boy. Now, there's a gentleman that WCOA owes a great debt of gratitude to.
Well, everyone that I've talked to so far in these conversations of bygone days has mentioned that same thing. 37 years have elapsed, and WCOA is still going strong here in 1963. Can you see any significant changes in radio or the approach of people to radio while we are still the wonderful city of advantages, which incidentally is what the WCOA call letter stands for? Do you think radio has, other than technically, has changed greatly? You were looking back.
Oh, it's the changes are just too numerous. It's grown so far now that it would just take you hours and hours and hours to scratch the surface. But I would like to say that WCOA was known then as the wonderful city of advantages. That was coined right away after the call letters were issued.
And do you think it still is the wonderful city of advantages?
Yes, I think Pensacola is a fine city. I've lived in other towns, but I moved to Pensacola as a youngster. It's the only town I've been homesick for. And while I was away in the service, we never missed an opportunity to tell them about Pensacola. And I still think a great deal of it. It's my home, and I'm proud of it.
Well, we are too, very much. And Eddie Collins, our thanks to you for sharing with us reminiscences in this, the 37th anniversary of WCOA.
Well, thank you very much for asking me to even participate a little bit. I really appreciate it.